Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this second video about interactive theorem proving, I want to demonstrate to you how you can use the Coq tool, the Coq Proof Assistant, for doing proofs in piano arithmetic. So let's get started. First of all, let's go back to where piano arithmetic was introduced. So in piano arithmetic, we have the following signature consisting of a constant symbol, function symbols, and these six axioms followed by this axiom scheme. So the first thing I will do in this demonstration is putting this this signature and these axioms in the Coq Proof Assistant. So to do that, I open the Coq Integrated Development Environment, and I'll from scratch start writing it. And I'll refer back to the slides to explain what I'm doing with respect to what I explained in the previous video. So first of all, I want to declare the signature, and I want to introduce for it some notation. And then I want to add the axioms as they are listed. So to do that, I start with introducing a module type. And a module type you can compare with packages in other programming languages. Yeah, but it's a special kind of package because it allows you to introduce new axioms to the system that the system then accepts as a given. The first thing that I do is I declare a special type, and in this case this is the type representing the set of all natural numbers. And this is the type over which the quantifiers will range as well. In first order logic, naturally there is only one such type, and all objects that you talk about are of the same type, but in a system like Coq you have to explicitly declare it. Then I introduce a constant symbol, let's say introduce z, to be of that type that I have introduced. And then I introduce the unary function symbol for successor, s. I will also introduce a binary function symbol for the plus, and a binary function symbol the times. This is now what I have written. The nice thing in Coq is that you can evaluate the commands step by step. And to do that, I can feed it to the interactive system that runs in the background. So each time I execute a command, you see that it becomes green. And on the right hand side, these are two output windows that give you back some diagnostic information. This one gives the messages, and here you see the current state of the proof assistant, which is empty. Later on, you will see new things appear there. So now the proof assistant accepts N as a new type, and then it indeed accepts Z as a constant in that type, S as a unary function symbol of that type, plus as a binary function symbol of that type, and times as a binary function symbol of that type. Let me now introduce some notation, because the system, the syntax of the system can be extended on the fly. So for that I introduce notation. I will write 0 to mean the z constant symbol. Furthermore, I define the infix plus to mean the plus function symbol, and I will write the infix times to mean the times function symbol. So now whenever I write, for instance, 0 plus 0, then the system understands this 0 standing for the z constant symbol over here, the plus to understand it is understood as this binary function symbol, and that 0 also as the z. Now you can also use plus zz. Now I have to maybe explain a little bit about how the function application syntax works in Coq, because you cannot write it as usual in some programming languages as so, this is a different notation. Instead, you have to partially apply the function each time. So for instance, I can say, what is plus? Plus is a function that takes something of n, that takes another thing of n, and then produces something of n. I can partially apply plus with one term of type n. So plus 0, plus z, is a partial application which then takes another term of type n. Well, and if I supply then indeed another term of type n, then I get 0 plus 0 is n. And note that putting these brackets around, these are the same. So application, function, application, associates to the left. Okay, so that is introducing syntactic sugar. Now let's add the axioms of piano arithmetic. So going back to the slides, you see the first axiom is for all x, 0 is not equal to the successor of x. So that one I can translate as follow. I introduce an axiom. Let me call it axiom 1. For all x, it is the case that 0 is not equal to the successor of x. And I can write these brackets or I cannot write them, depending on how you wish to read it. But I'll just not write them. That makes it a bit easier. Okay. So axiom 1 is now declared. It is now added to the system as an axiom. Now, do note that this not equal symbol is written in ASCII by the smaller than, bigger than. Okay, now I'll add the second axiom, axiom 2, which states for all x and for all y, if the successor x is equal to the successor of y, then x is equal to y. So, okay, for all x, for all y, if it is the case that the successor of x is equal to the successor of y, so you can read these as terms, part of the equality. If this is the case, then x is equal to y. And this implication is nested underneath the quantifier as such. Okay, this declares axiom 2. Let's then continue with the next axiom. For all x, x plus 0 is equal to x. For all x, x plus 0 is equal to x. That's also accepted by the system. I can also make a mistake. And then suppose I would have written x plus 0 is xx, then it would complain that xx is a name that is not found in the environment. So this is the typical error you would expect in other programming languages as well. Okay, let's continue with axiom 4. Axiom 4 states for all x and y, x plus successor of y is equal to the successor of x plus y. For all x, y. Oh, and by the way, this for all x, y is syntactic sugar for all x, for all y. Yeah? So that's why I shorten it. For all x, y, x plus the successor of x is equal to the successor of, and now I use brackets, x plus y. Yeah? So this successor unary function is applied to the result of x plus y. Whereas here, the plus is applied to x on the left and the successor of, oh, there's a mistake. I should write y on the right. Now, axiom 5, let's consider that one. It is x times 0 is 0. X times 0 is 0. Now, axiom 6 is for all x, y, x times the successor of y is x plus x times y. And I make use here of parentheses to make sure that the expression is not ambiguous. Okay, so these are the first six axioms, but then we have to also encode the seventh axiom, but this is an axiom scheme. And so it stands for an arbitrary first order formula that we can put in here. Now, Koch is not a first order theorem prover. It's a higher order theorem prover. So I will encode it in a special way. I will not explain too much how it works. That's maybe a bit weird that I don't explain it. But let's just do it so that we can continue the exercise. So axiom 7 is the point of a higher order proof assistant is that you can not only quantify over the individuals, like for all individuals or for there exists an individual, it also allows you to quantify over formulas themselves. And that's what I do now. So I basically say that for all, let's call it P, for all formulas P, I want to say that P zero has to hold. And if for all X, P X implies the P of the successor of X, then we have that for all X, P X. And I now here have used brackets, so but you can also make use of the different syntax. This is all the same, huh? Whether I write it like so or whether I like write it like so. That's all syntactically the same. So I'll here the brackets are needed. So I'll write it like so. Okay, so the axiom 7, now this axiom scheme is also accepted. And we can check how the system understands the axiom 7. And you here see now, okay, it quantifies for all p. And it says p is a function which takes a particular element of our type n. Eh? And then it produces something which is called prop, standing for a proposition. This is just the type of all, let's say, formulas. Eh? So for all formulas that you could form in this proof assistant. So let's then indeed check whether, for instance, this for all x, zero is not equal to sx. If we check that one, we see, hey, what is it? It's just this for all statement. Okay. Good. So now that we have introduced the signature and the axioms, we can then now start making use of them by deriving their consequences. So to do that, I start another module, let's call it piano facts, and import the signature we have defined before. So it is within this context that we still have access to the axioms. Eh? So for instance, whenever I check axiom 5 here, you can see, oh yeah, axiom 5, which was it? It was that for all x, x times 0 is equal to 0. Eh? So what we can do now here is we can formulate our lemma, and the proof assistant will then step by step help us constructing a proof of this lemma. Of course, the proof assistant only allows you to complete such a proof if such a proof exists. And so a proof only exists of the consequences of our axioms. And so if there is something that is not a consequence of the axioms, then we cannot derive it either. Okay, so let's state the lemma. Let's say lemma, give it a name, lemma 1, and we formulate it as follows. For all x, we want to say 0 plus x is equal to x. So now you see in this screen over here, there is an update of what the system is doing. Previously, all the commands that we supplied to the system were accepted as such. But now the system says, yes, I want to accept this as a lemma, but there is still something called a proof obligation for the user to meet. So in this case, we are obliged to construct a proof object, and the proof object then is a witness for the validity of this of this formula. Now in this proof object, we can make use of the previously assumed axioms. So let's construct a proof object. The first thing we do, and most of this will be applying rules that are also rules available in first order logic or proof systems for first order logic. So the first thing we do is if you want to prove that something that this universal quantification is valid, well, what we do is we introduce we take an arbitrary variable and for that continue our proof. So we basically say what we want to do is, hey, we want to have a for all x, and then we have to want to have a certain property to hold. Hey, and this is also what you see is the conclusion of our axiom scheme over here. If we take for p to be the formula 0 plus x is equal to x. So what we can do is we can apply axiom 7, and then the proof state is updated. So for a successful application of axiom 7, so being able to derive this for this p, we have to satisfy its the assumptions that needed for applying the modus ponens rule in this implication. So that basically amounts to that we have to show the base case P0 and the step case in which Px implies the P of successor of X. So that is also now stated. Eh? So the proof obligation that we still have to meet is now updated to reflect that. Now you see here the top level symbol is a conjunction, right? That's also the same thing as what you have in our axiom scheme. Eh? So to be able to derive the consequence, we have to supply evidence of both the left part of the conjunction and the right part of the conjunction. So we're now at this point. And so we have applied the axiom from schematic axiom 7. We have taken the formula 0 plus x is equal to x. And now we're in the base case. The base case says 0 plus 0 is equal to 0. Okay, so that is stated here. 0 plus 0 is equal to 0. The first thing I do is I split it up into two goals. The first goal is the base case. And this is a comment, by the way. It's ignored by the proof assistant. So we focus now first on the first case, namely the base case. We have 0 plus 0 is equal to 0. And informally we stated, hey, this can be discharged, this can be proven by applying axiom 3. And if you look at axiom 3, it basically states x plus 0 is equal to x. So if we take for this x over here 0, then we indeed have 0 plus 0 equals 0. So we can apply axiom 3. Now the system states, hey, this subproof is complete, so this part is done of the proof, but we still have some other proof obligations to meet. Namely, we have the proof obligation for the step case. Okay, so let's look at the step case. In the step case, we see that we have to show that for all x, under the assumption that 0 plus x is equal to x, we have to show that 0 plus the successor of x is equal to the successor of x. So this is then a rule from logic. We introduce an arbitrary variable x so that we can complete the proof, and we assume the hypothesis. As an hypothesis, the antecedent of the implication. So let's say we introduce them by giving them the names x and assumption. So now here we, in our context, have available to us some variable x. That's only part of this proof. And we could have also given it a different name, let's say z. Then you see that now this name is z, and our proof obligation is also expressed in terms of z. The name we give it is irrelevant. Let's keep it to x to reflect what is on the slides. Now we have this as an assumption, 0 plus x is equal to x. That's also what we have. We assume 0 plus x is equal to x. So that's everything on the top of this line is what we know as an assumption. And on the bottom of the line is the remaining proof obligation, what we have to show. What we need to show is 0 plus the successor of x is equal to the successor of x. 0 plus the successor of x is equal to the successor of x. Now, to do that, we can look at what we did before. Well, we know that 0 plus the successor of x, by applying axiom 4, must be equal to the successor of 0 plus x. So to do that, I want to apply that over here as in the subterm of our goal, of our conclusion. Now to do that, I can make use of rewrite command, as it is called. So I can rewrite using axiom 4, and then you see, hey, what happened? Our 0 plus sx over here is replaced by the successor of 0 plus x. Now this rewrite command is showing you that this interactive theorem prover under the hood makes use of some automation. And so this rewrite command over here that I issue under the hood does some automatic processing, because it is looking for whatever is applicable wherever this axiom 4 is applicable. It looks at the left hand side x plus sx, well, and it sees it is applicable at this place, and then it automatically fills in this x over here with the 0 and this x over here with this y, and then it knows, oh well, the right hand side of this axiom is the successor of x plus y with these particular instantiations of x and y, and then replaces that subterm by the subterm on the right-hand side of the equality in the axiom. And you can also write this out manually. We can, for instance, we can state that we know that the axiom 4 holds as it is done on the slides, and then manually apply transitivity of equality. But I'll spare you the details. I'll just continue with using this rewrite technique. Okay, so now the next goal we have is we want to show that s of 0 plus x is equal to x. And that is also what we want to show over here, that s of 0 plus x is equal to sx. Well, and we know that holds by our assumption, because our assumption is 0 plus x is equal to x. So to do that, what we can do is we can use again the rewrite command, and then we say, okay, we rewrite using our assumption. And what we now get is we have s of x is equal to s of x. Why? Because it recognizes, hey, we here have a subterm which is 0 plus x, which is precisely the same as what is the left-hand side of the equality of our assumption. And it replaces this term by the right-hand side of the equality. So then you will get s of x is equal to s of x. And as soon as you have that the equality between two terms, and those two terms are syntactically identical, then by reflexivity you know that equality must hold, right? So that's a property of equality. For any x, x is equal to x. And that's what we make use of by stating the reflexivity command. So now the system says that there are no more goals, there are no more open proof obligations, so that means that we have completed a proof. And now, whenever we close off the proof with QED, this lemma 1 is now accepted, and lemma 1 is now part of what is considered valid in this context. Okay, so it is indeed the case that lemma 1 is a consequence of the axioms. Okay, so we have established that. That's quite nice. Then we can continue with the next lemma. And this next lemma, we say for all x, for all y, the successor of x plus y is equal to the successor of x plus y. Let's state it as follows. Lemma 2. So for all x, y, the successor of x plus y is equal to the successor of x plus y. Okay, so before the system wants to accept this lemma, it requires the user to construct a proof object. Well, and to do that, we can again look at what we did before. Well, before what we did was we applied an instantiation of the schematic axiom. And for that we have explicitly given a particular formula, phi. And in our encoding of it, phi stands for this p over here. If I would naively apply this axiom 7, then the system, it guesses the wrong phi. It now guesses as a phi the whole statement, the overall statement. And that's not what we want. So I can specialize this application by specifying, just like I did on the slide, what formula phi we pick. Well, we pick here the formula sy plus x is equal to sy plus x. And here we have swapped y and x compared over here. Well, we can also do that in the system. And we do that by making use of a lambda notation. So I say here, I introduce a lambda. So I abstract away from x. And I say, okay, I want to apply this axiom with sy plus x is s of y plus x. Oh, it now complains that this y is not found. And the reason why it's not found is because it's not in our context. These x and y are still quantified over. So what we have to do is we have to introduce them in our context and give them names. So this is similar to what you do, for instance, in first order logic when you want to introduce a universal quantifier. You reserve a particular variable. You can give it an arbitrary name. We can give it the name x, we can give it the name y. And now we see that the goal now is with respect to this specifically named x and y. So by introducing it, Now we can make use of X and Y in our context, also in the application of Axiom 7. Over here, this Y now refers to the Y we have introduced in our context. However, this X over here, we can even give it a different name. We can give it the name Z, for instance. It's the same. Now we have the same proof obligation modulo the renaming of X by Z. And then this X is bound by the X that is introduced here over here. Because this you can think of this as a lambda X. And this one searches for the nearest enclosing abstraction. Okay, if we do that, then we get an error. It's not the right number of arguments. Oh yes, because I need to specify that I want to use this for P. Oh, now we get another error. We are unable to unify S, Y plus X equals to S, Y plus X with S, Z plus Y. Ah, so I made a mistake. I renamed the wrong one. So I said it throws X, Y, and I gave then this the name X and this the name Y. But the point over here is that we want to give this the name Y and this the name X. So that is swapping the names. Okay, so I do it like this. So as you can see, it doesn't really matter whether we take this formula or whether we prove some syntactic renaming of it. So if we change the name X over here and we change all the X's that are bound to it, to say to Y and simultaneously rename this Y to X, that's all fine. So that's indeed what we do here. So we take this Y to be what previously was X and this X to what was previously Y. And if we now apply the Axiom Scheme 7, then we can continue. Now we have still two obligations. Let me split them. We again have the base case and we have the step case. So in the base case, let's see what's on the slide. We need to show that S y plus 0 is equal to the successor of y plus 0. And that's also what we see here. So that is the successor of y plus 0 is equal to the successor of y plus 0. Okay, and how do we do that? Ah, so here we say that s y plus 0 is equal to s y by axiom 3. So let's again use rewrite axiom 3 to obtain the same. Oh yes, so as you can see is that the proof obligation that we now have to show is updated. Before we had to show that s y plus 0 is equal to s y plus 0. The latter one between brackets. But after rewriting the left hand, we only have to show still s y is equal to s y plus 0. Now, what do we say in the slides? Well, we say in the slides that this y underneath the successor is equal to y plus 0 as well. And that's because that's a symmetric variant of what we have also from axiom 3. So if we rewrite axiom 3 again, now the second time, in the first time, it was searching for where do we find a particular instance of this axiom. Well, by instantiating this successor y for this x over here, we get that s, the successor of y plus 0 is equal to the successor of y. And that's also what we obtain then here at the left-hand side. But now if we apply the axiom 3 again, it will apply to this plus 0 on the right-hand side. And now again, we have the successor of y is equal to the successor of y. And that of course is true because equality is reflexive. So for any x is equal to x is equal to x. Okay, so now the base case is completed, just like what we have done on the slide. Now we have to continue with the step case. In the step case, we assume that the successor of y plus x is equal to the successor of y plus x. And then we have to show, well, then it also holds for that the successor of y plus the successor of x is equal to the successor of y plus the successor over here of x. Okay, so to do that, I introduce some names. So I want to introduce x and assumption, just like what I did before. Okay, that is possible, but hey, there is a problem. Whenever I want to do that, this x overshadows the x that we have previously introduced. And then the system complains that this overshadowing of variables is not allowed. So what we have to do is we have to go back and we have to revise what we are doing, because after we have applied this axiom 7, no longer anywhere in our goal we have an occurrence of x. And so then the x in our context is irrelevant and we can clear it out explicitly. And then we can still continue with the base case. But now if we're in the step case, no longer this conflict of overshadowing variables occurs. And we can introduce our x and assumption. So now we are in the state as reflected on the slide. We assume that s y plus x is equal to the successor of y plus x together. And now we have to show that indeed if we wrap this x over here and this x over here in a successor, that we can derive this from our assumption. Well, what do we do in the slide? Well, what we do is we first establish, hey, this holds by axiom 4 on the left-hand side, so we can write that, axiom 4. Okay, so the left-hand side of the equality indeed was changed. So since we here have a successor, we also here have a successor, it matches up properly and we can apply the axiom. Now the next step is, hey, this left-hand side over, this whenever we rewrite the left-hand side over here by this, then we know that what is in between the successor, so what is written over here, sy plus x, is the same as what is written here. So we can replace this sy plus x by what is the right-hand side of our assumption. Okay, so we rewrite with our assumption. So now we have s of sy plus x must equal to s of y plus s of x. And well, that's the last one, the successor of y plus x, that's this part here, is equal to the successor of y plus sx. Well, and that is indeed what we have here. We can now apply over here, we can apply also axiom 4. And then you see indeed that we here have an identical term. So then the reflexivity holds. And that closes then the proof, and we can then let the system accept it. What would happen if we want to say to the system, hey, although there is still a proof obligation, can you accept my proof? Well, no, then the system will complain, you're attempting to save an incomplete proof, and that is not allowed. And this is also reflecting back on the property of proof assistance. The proof assistance will make sure that you don't make any errors in your proofs. So it will help you check whether your proofs contain any errors. And indeed, it will only make it show up green whenever there are no mistakes in the proof. So let's then go to the last consequence of our axiomatization of arithmetic. That is the commutativity of the plus operator. We state, okay, we have a theorem 1. We can say for all x, y, x plus y is y plus x. And again, we are into the mode where the proof assistant requires of us to provide a proof object. And the proof object has as a conclusion this formula. So what do we do on the slides? Oh yes, so we want to apply our schematic and our schematic axiom 7 with this particular formula. Well, we now know how to do that. We can introduce the x and y, and then here we have, it suffices that to show x plus y is y plus x. Well, let's apply the axiom 7. Now choose as a formula the following. Let's say x plus y is y plus x. This then remains us with two goals, or with two proof obligations, the base case and the step case. So in the base case, what we have is we need to show 0 plus y equals y plus 0. And that's also what we have here, 0 plus y equals y plus 0. And why is that the case? Well, we wrote on the slides that 0 plus y equals y by our lemma. Okay, so that we can rewrite lemma 1. Zero plus x is x. Now 0 plus y, if we take y for x over here, that indeed works. Sure, the left-hand side was indeed replaced by y. And what did we write furthermore? Oh yeah, y is equal to y plus 0 by our axiom. Rewrite axiom 3. Indeed, and then we have y equals y, and that follows from reflexivity. Sure, So now this subproof, so this part of the proof is complete, but we still have to do the second part of the proof, which is the step case. Well, on the slide I stated, assume that x plus y is equal to y plus x. Then we have to show that if we wrap x around with the successor on both sides, that this follows from our assumption. Okay, so what we can then do is we introduce the x assumption. We have the same problem as we have before, that x is already used. We can clear it out because over here we go back basically. Huh? You see that these green lines show where the window over here is where the window over here is the current proof state, as it is called, is shown over there. So after we have executed all these commands, the proof state is as shown over here. Well, here you see that the goal does not mention any x, because the x's that are mentioned are these x zeros, but they bind to this quantifier and not to the x we have in our context. So we can simply clean up our context and we get the same goal, but now renamed for x, because there is no longer a conflict. Okay, and then we can introduce x and our assumption. So now we're in the state that we assume x plus y is equal to y plus x, as written here, and that our goal is as the successor of x plus y is equal y to plus the successor of x. And that's precisely what I stated here. Then what we say is on the left-hand side of the equality, we can say, okay, well, the successor of x plus y is equal to the successor of x plus y by our second lemma. So we can rewrite lemma 2, and you see indeed, hey, the left-hand side of our equality is now changed. And then we say that, okay, this s x plus y is equal to s y plus x by making use of our assumption underneath the successor function symbol. Sure, we can also do that. We rewrite with our assumption. So then you see indeed, hey, this x plus y is changed to x plus y. Yeah? So if I go back a little bit here, you see, after applying the command rewrite assumption, this part is changed. And then the last step is, hey, on the if this s y plus x is equal to y plus s of x by axiom 4, that we can also do, we rewrite axiom 4, and this axiom 4 applies to this part of the goal that we have. And then we obtain that the term shown on the left and the term shown on the right are identical. So then we can apply reflexivity. This closes the proof. And this then indeed allows us to establish that the theorem as written over here, if I encode it in using the proof assistant, then the proof assistant says, okay, we are able to construct a proof object and every rule that is applied correctly. So there is no error made in the proof. So yeah, that demonstrates to you, I did not explain all the details, but at least it demonstrates to you an example of how to use a proof assistant. My intention here is to maybe get you excited about the topic. Maybe you want to investigate and learn it by yourself, or continue your studies in this direction to learn more about this topic. Thank you for watching this video.